Hey, this is Jim McDonald. Welcome to episode 110 of the PowerCast. Episode number one of the PowerCast came online 2 years ago on September 18th, 2013. We've learned so much since then, and we've gained so many viewers and listeners since then. We appreciate you, all of you individually, so much for giving this opportunity to keep the show rolling. We've had some of our best weeks recently. The last 6-8 months have been crazy. So again, thank you. Keep sharing the show, keep watching the show. Subscribe to this channel, like these episodes, get on iTunes and give us a 5-star if you can. We appreciate all of that. Now I wanna give a shout out to Alex Kett. Alex is and his friend Trey are big listeners of the show, big fans, and Alex was in a motorcycle accident and he's pretty banged up, he's feeling kind of bummed, so we just want to say get well soon, man. I'm sure it's all going to work out, but get well soon. Also, shout out to dbsbarbell.com, DBS Barbell in Sydney, Australia. They listen to the show in the gym, which is awesome. One of their owners, Andrew Jansen, reached out to me and told me what was going on there. So we just want to say shout out to you guys and thanks for watching / listening. I'm not sure which one it is that they do all the time. I'm sure at least listen. This episode is Jon Andersen. Jon Andersen, let me start by saying that Jon Andersen was an early guest and he is the owner of one of the best poop stories in the history of the PowerCast. And so we talk a good bit about poop for the first 15 or 20 minutes of the show. So if poop talk is not your thing, you can skip past that part and there's plenty of good content beyond that. And if you love a good poop story or some good poop talk, you will enjoy this part because it's pretty funny, honestly. We enjoyed ourselves through this part. But anyway, also, Jon is the author of The Deep Water Method, and a couple of times in the course of the show, he mentions deep water. What deep water is, in a nutshell, is doing things that you didn't think you could do and doing them successfully, and that gives you confidence going forward into the future. If you want to know more about The Deep Water Method, I suggest that you go to deepwatermethod.com. There's lots of information there, and you can even pick up his book and however you want to deal with it, but you need to know because we mentioned it a couple of times in the episode. Our sponsors for this episode, howmuchyoubench.net, thepowermagazine.com, Compex USA at shopcompex.com, and Rogue Fitness at thepowercast.com/rogue, also cavemancoffeecoat.com. As you know, we're running contests, and our contest winner for this week is, I gotta look down here in my notes, PalmaFit, Palma_fit on Instagram. The next contest we will run on Instagram itself, at Mark Mills PowerCast. Look for that probably this weekend while we're at the Olympia. We'll be there Friday, Saturday, the days of the show. I don't know which booth number we are, but I will try to put it in here. I can't remember off the top of my head. Anyway, all the normal YouTube stuff, likes, shares, all that stuff I talked about at the beginning, all that stuff that makes such a big difference to us, we'd really appreciate it. And without further ado, here's episode 110 of the PowerCast.
Well, that's right in your ear, isn't it?
That was nice.
Recorded live at Super Training Gym in Rosa, Sacramento, California. The strongest gym in the West. This is Mark Bell's PowerCast.
I get shit for this all the time now that sponsored Nickerson's not here, so I can't. I had to record this myself. We had a sponsor change, and people like every single week on YouTube are like, "Where's Nickerson?"
Shophimdo.com.
His voice would be an amazing intro.
Silent Mike and Jim McDee.
Just the intro.
Here's your host.
What is it? What is
it? Just whatever. Just a script.
Yeah, just a little script.
Just welcome to Mark Bell's PowerCast.
I don't read well, so you're going to have to give it to me.
Yeah, we'll read it and you repeat it. That'd be perfect.
Good.
The voice. You ever do any voiceover stuff? You ever think about anything like that?
You know, actually, Rick Bassman actually contacted me about that. We just never connected on the project.
Ah. Yeah, you do have a lovely singing voice. Oh. You got a little something right here, too. I think it might be a little bit of spooge.
It is.
Yeah, we got excited earlier today.
Where's Junior when you need him? That's my bulldog.
Oh, yeah, your bulldog.
That's right.
Playing cleanup.
He wanted to let that shit hit the ground.
Oh, my God. It's disgusting.
Pardon me. He'll just clean up anything. Absolutely anything.
There we go. Okay. I think we're all on.
He's like a little vacuum.
All right. Before we get started, I have a little something.
Uh-oh.
I got a little something for...
And it's right down here.
For Silent Mike.
What's going on?
A little something for
Victoria's
you.
Secret. Here we go.
What is this? What is going on?
In honor of his insta-famousness.
Oh, my God.
Look at that.
Got a Red Ranger. Jim. He is handsome and jacked.
Does he come with a deadlift bar?
I don't see a deadlift bar.
Yeah, that's the question. Weightlifter.
If you look at the very top there, though, you'll see that he comes with his own lifting straps.
Look at that.
Amazing. Amazing. So handsome.
The Silent Mike edition.
I thought when you put that up, it said cheeks. I was like, oh, geez.
Oh, yeah, deep cheeks.
I was like, God damn, this is tight.
Yeah, the deep cheeks. Make sure you get a little closer to the microphone there, buddy.
Yeah,
there we go.
Just pretend it's a big dick, and you'll probably be more comfortable that way.
Below the Muppet, kind of. Yeah, this is what we like to say. All right, that was my thing.
So typically, we're known for poop stories. On a similar note, you have another story: a first occasion breaking of virginity, or something new that's happened to you recently that happened back there. You have issues back there now that you didn't have the rest of your lifting career.
Jesus Christ. So you know, you're talking to a guy who's
the world.
Next year going to be have 30 years of training, and some very aggressive style training at that. And you know, you hear of people that shit their pants, get hemorrhoids, have all sorts of problems under a heavy bar, and I've been keeping it clean for 30 years, and then.
Power to you, props.
Fuck. And it's somehow, some way, I'm on a toilet and I, you know, get into an altercation with a turd and it put the hurt on me. And I got a whopping hemorrhoid, goddammit.
Losing battle.
You know, I know it. And then so then to further the whole thing, I'm like, it hurts and I know it's in there. And I gotta know. So I get myself cleaned up as best I can with the paper and I'm stretch out so I can reach the corner and I can't feel it. The sphincter is nice and smooth. You know, what the hell's going on here? So I give it a push and I say, oh, it hurts. So it's up in there.
Uh-huh.
It's a knuckle in there. It's all the way up. You know, what the hell a deal is. So then as this whole thing goes on, now every time I take a dump, this thing gets pushed down out of my asshole and hangs in there.
Oh, yeah.
It
goes from a stalactite to a stalagmite.
So figure, you know, for a guy who shits minimum half a dozen times a day, you know, I got, before it was simple, man, nice clean cutter, give it a pinch, down it goes, piece of paper, two, I'm out of there. Now I've got this, like, permanent dingleberry hanging that is just collecting turd. It's just, to clean that thing is just... It's just not working.
Or do you have to invest in a bidet or something?
Oh, that'd be.
I don't know. We're
good
only
day, bad day.
We're only about 48 hours into this deal, so I'm learning.
Oh, you're new. Yeah, this I is think Mark new. Is the experienced one in everything anal.
Yeah, all things anal. You come to me. Pretty bad.
He taught me everything I know.
Yeah, so you know, it's been a learning experience, and. I can't imagine before this thing is finally over with that there's not going to be some crazy shit.
There may not be an end.
I'll keep you informed.
Please.
I will keep you informed. But
well,
I've been walking around super training looking for somebody that's got the sack to clip their fingernails, put a little cream on their pinky and give it a run, but nobody will step up to the plate.
Yeah, why can't someone help you out?
Jesus Christ, what the hell's wrong with the people in here?
It's hard to find good help.
It is.
You know, in Japan, they'd probably do that, right?
The
Japanese?
Boys, they would have a choice.
Yeah. You know? Yeah.
I'd grab his pinky, put a little cream on there.
Do it yourself.
Look down. And he'd look at, whoa.
I remember I got done with a match, and like one of the guys that like ran the company that I was wrestling for, like smacks me on the ass. He's like, nice heap. I was like, oh, thanks. That was awkward. They're just staring at you while you change. Like, oh, okay, this is great.
That's awesome.
Like, this is getting to be kind of weird.
A little bit of ownership right there, I guess, huh?
Oh my God.
Like, we brought you here, we paid for you, we slap your ass.
Yeah exactly.
Well, I mean, you're known for not eating a lot of carbs, and you know, people who go on low carb diets pretty often get, you know, like constipation issues and
yeah, do you have a Metamucil sponsorship with Michael Strahan?
But here's the thing: it doesn't take much, you know, to keep yourself going clean. You need a little Metamucil first thing in the morning,
right?
And as long as you're eating enough, you know, proper grains in your diet, you're going to be okay. Now, keep in mind, you know, I'm kind of a Rain Man type, meaning that everything's on a schedule. There's a time and a place, and I just go.
Wapner.
That's right, exactly. So for that person that doesn't have that rigidity in their schedule and misses their Metamucil and doesn't get their greens for the day, they're going to have a serious battle. Mm. You know, they're going to be – it's not just going to be sit down.
Coffee can help, too. It'll help you blow it out.
Yeah. You know, that very well could be the culprit of my hemorrhoid. I don't know how the hell this whole thing came about. But the bottom line is that you're very correct. You're the territory can get a little sketchy if you don't hold true to what you need to keep things moving.
We're going to have people that are very analytical who are going to chime in on this podcast. And they're going to be like, oh, it's because he has high blood pressure or something. They're going to be all kinds of theories will pop up. He's not eating carbs, so this is not getting absorbed, and that's not happening. Blah, blah, blah.
Everyone's
blah, blah.
A butt doctor nowadays.
Yeah. That's it. That's
everybody
it.
Knows.
That's it. Yeah, how does everybody know everybody else's ass so well? No.
Because the internet's up our ass every day, all the time.
Yeah, that's true. Let's go over some math, because you really schooled us really well on the math, and it's helped us out a lot here at Super Training.
Yeah,
I think it was.
It had to do with elevation. You're in an airplane, I believe.
Yeah, and it was like. It was like 15 farts per every shart.
Oh, well, let me tell you, that story has since been, it's bettered itself. So
you've refined the math a little bit on this.
Well, it's not even about the math anymore. It's about the absolute toxicity of what's coming out of my asshole on a plane 24 hours after a bodybuilding contest. I mean, listen, I'm going to be the first one to stand up and say, I love the smell of my own brand. I'll waft it in my own face before I waft it in yours. You know,
that's respectful enough.
Absolutely.
That's fair enough.
Absolutely. Smelt it, dealt it.
Absolutely. Right, so the new marker for, you know, turning an airplane upside down, so to speak, is when...
like in flight. Denzel in flight.
That's right. That's right. Is when the stewardess or the steward, whichever we want to call
it. That's very politically correct of you.
Yeah. So when one of these, I'll get back to speaking like I normally do. So when one of these fucking gay bastards grabs a fucking air freshener can and comes and squirts it right over the top of you, you know you're fucking the place up.
That's great.
So at that point, it's not a numbers game of how many times did you do it. It's the fact that every time you do it, this people are hitting that fucking button. So that he'll come squirt that shit over the top of my head. And it actually, this last one, it was pretty good. It
sounds like you need these special charcoal underwear.
Oh, yeah.
Zortex.
The last one actually started before I got to the airplane. It was quite surprising. So the last show I did, I finished up, got up to my room, washed the shit off, and my other half and I, Terry, we went out to a dinner, you know. I mean, she supports me so well, so I wanted to make sure we went to
the Terry's jacked, by the way, just so everybody out there knows. She's yoked.
And so we go to this restaurant, and it's pretty hopping, and so there was no table. So we went to the bar, and we were having some hors d'oeuvres, and I was having a Diet Coke, and that Diet Coke after, I had to throw that in, so that's like heaven after you haven't been able to drink water for a couple of days. Anyway, so just with the couple of Quest bars and the hors d'oeuvres that I ate after the contest, and between the time I showered and we got down to the restaurant, so and my stomach's bubbling, you know, and so I know they're coming. So I dropped the first one off, you know, and I look over at Terry, and just the look on my face, she knows what's coming. She's doing this. And there's people on all sides, right? And so the lady next to me, she says to the bartender, she says, you know, there's something really stinky on the floor over there. And Terry and I look at each other and we're like, there is, you know, yeah. What is that? You know, and so the bartender
like
comes
it's
up.
Weird. It seems like it's coming from my seat.
And he's spraying shit down on the ground, right?
Lysol.
And the smell that's goes great. Away because obviously it's airborne. You know, there's yeah. nothing on the ground, right? And then, you know.
Airborne.
Chemical warfare
in people's mouths.
You know, and then, you know, 2-3 minutes later, here comes the next one, you know. And the lady said, excuse me, sir, it smells down there again. Anyway, so long and short of it, you know, we Tara and I went from a very, very crowded bar to a bar with ourselves. No, there you go. But it is toxic shit, man.
You know it's bad if the cook leaves. You know? Yeah.
a crowd is usually the best case scenario.
You guys can make your own food. Though,
You know, I love it. There's in my position, there's nothing better than dropping a nice one and just sitting and people watching.
Yeah, doing like a drive-by.
That's great. I love it, you know, because you get the people are going about their way and all of a sudden because what happens is they start blaming people by their looks. You know? They start going.
Yeah. Always blame the fat guy.
That's right. And they always think it's, you know, someone in their group, you know.
That's like after you take a shit and you come out of like a public bathroom like, oh, my God, someone blew it up in there. I don't know who did what, but somebody did something terrible in there. Don't go in there.
I think I remember a story about your mom when your dad was in the hospital in New York. Blowing up some bathroom, walking out saying, some girl, don't go in there. Some girl blew that bathroom.
Yeah.
Now, of course, it was her.
Somebody cremated that bathroom. Do not go in there. I don't know who did that. Somebody did something gross in there. So let's go back to the math because I think it's important. So what about like when you're doing a squat? Like let's say because right. you're known for high rep squats, you did 405 for 43 reps?
43, yeah.
That's amazing. But how many farts, I mean, must have occurred? 43 reps, it must have been astronomical.
See, this is where the whole, you know, hemorrhoid thing has got me, you know, guessing. Because
I am flabbergasted right now. I'm
trying to find an equation.
It's a puzzle I can't put together here, fellas, because, you know, some of these numbers we're talking about, like that nasty set with 405, I'm keeping it clean.
Yeah.
There's no problems, you know? Yeah. And then, you know.
What, 495 for what, 20 something reps?
26. And then 6 plates of what, 585 for 17. And then 700 on the button for, I did that for, you know, multiple times at 10.
And not a single fart was spread.
No, because when I'm locked down like that, man, the sphincter is. It's on lockdown.
Not even one of the.
It's a straight lockdown.
Not even one of those.
I mean, it's the core is so tight. If I was to even relax enough to let that sphincter open up to let something get out of there,
it might blow your back out.
I'd just fold over at the waist and be done. Yeah. You know, that'd be it.
What about on the setup then? As you're getting tight on the unrack,
maybe a couple.
Maybe
it'll
let loose there.
You know, here again, this whole thing's got me guessing. I have never, ever, ever had an issue.
Me and Mike were like. Just utterly surprised today when we saw you fart on an isolation exercise.
Yeah, that's
not on
impressive.
A compound
well,
movement.
See, because here's the problem. So we've got this goddamn hemorrhoid, which is, you know, giving me a lot of grief, right? And I can't. I mean, you know, I normally
you can't you go know, full blast.
I sit on the toilet and I let the thing go, and it's this is my time. I dig this and I clear it out, right? Now, I can't relax enough to let this shit go. So I'm like, you know, I've been walking around here farting with these high-pitched deals because I can't relax enough.
Yeah.
There's
no bass in these farts at all. Yeah.
It's all treble, baby. Yeah. It's all treble.
It adds an extra note. It's like a fucking clarinet.
Because I can't relax enough to let the sphincter open up to let it gently come out, man.
You're going through a real crisis. You must not feel like yourself right now.
I'm telling you. So basically what you're hearing is you're hearing a buildup. So when I'm on that isolation movement, it's almost kind of like I don't have a choice in the matter, you know? So I guess it was simple.
I don't like where any of this is going.
Did I stop the set? No, you don't stop the set.
No.
You keep going. You just let it go.
For God's sakes, you
know?
No.
Yeah. The question is one of these, you know, as I try to let one of these farts sneak by the hemorrhoid, am I going to shit my pants? That's the question.
On a curl only.
Oh shit!
It was a curl and a tricep kickback.
Yeah,
or something.
It's like you're trying to sneak the fart past the hemorrhoid safely.
It's like,
but not pass a poop.
It's like a playground game. What is it? Red Rover or something? You're trying to sneak by.
Yeah, it's I got, like I said, it's a puzzle I have yet to put together. This is new to me, fellas. I'm learning as
maybe,
I go.
Maybe these people could tweet us their fucking responses. Yeah. These people probably know.
For those of you out there that have hemorrhoids and know what, please tell me what to do.
Yeah, tweet us.
Tell me
Let
what to
do. Let us know
what
the hell's going
yeah.
on.
Yeah. I need help. I need help.
Send them a finger with cream or send them 15 cents. That's send them something that can help.
That's right.
Metamucil scholarship. Yeah. Just positive thoughts may help it. Yeah. It's like a demon back there.
You know what? I'd love to think that's the case, but something telling me this hemorrhoid's angrier than a positive thought's going to help.
I think you should rub some yogurt on it. That'll help.
Greek yogurt. Sour cream.
Probiotics. Yeah.
Hey, you know, if it works as a lubricant, I'm not arguing. I just need the person with the finger.
Yeah.
And the finely groomed fingernail.
Who can we find, Silent Mike? Who do we know that's got a big enough schnoz for the job?
I asked him when no one was around, and he told me no.
Yeah, really?
No hard time. I have a hard time thinking he's going to accept on the podcast, but he wouldn't do it when I had him cornered.
I've done
about 20 minutes ago.
I've done it enough for Mark. I kind of retired from that gig.
Yeah.
No.
He's trying to stay away from buttholes. Yeah.
Butthole too much, surfer.
Too much
for
anal.
For those of you that never had the displeasure of meeting Jon Andersen in person, he's very forward, and we were having a conversation. We're talking about like family. We're talking about all kinds of stuff. We're having a great conversation. It's actually a much deeper conversation than you would expect two meatheads to have. But mid-sentence, he's like talking about his daughter or something, and he's so proud of her and stuff like that, and then he's just like... He's like, so anyway, you know, she's really doing great, and I'm just so happy for her, and things are just going so.
That's the high pitched. I know. Shit, man. I know.
It just like doesn't skip a beat. He just lets it go and just keeps on.
It is what it is, man.
He bent over and grabbed some stuff out of his bag earlier and just letting it loose.
That was about 3 minutes long.
It was
a whole trumpet chorus.
I bent over and I felt the pressure. I thought, all right, this is an opportunity.
You know? You saw a portal and you had to go through that.
Right, that's right. That's
yeah.
Right.
When opportunity calls, you got
to
take it.
That hemorrhoid is trying to go through the portal.
I wish we'd recorded that because, like I said at the time, it sounded like
of recording of those of his farting today.
If Toy Story was about farting, that's what it would sound like. The sound effects.
There are certain positions though that are just very comfortable for farts. Bending over to grab a bag. Stepping in. Once I step in my car, for some reason, my body just wants to fart as soon as I sit down. It's like mentally, like okay, no one's around, and physically, your knees are kind of up.
Farting into the cushion of your car.
I've never put two and two together, but there are
positions. Oh, you're learning some stuff too.
The physical and mental. Airplanes.
Leg press.
Yeah. Bart Kwan told me that airplane seats must be made of that Zortex because sometimes you just can't smell farts in an airplane.
Well, it depends on the seat, though.
It's not got to do with the seat. It's got to do with the fact that I'm not on the motherfucking plane.
Normal farts can't be smelt on a plane, but.
The Southwest, like the older planes, you can fart on them pretty good, and you can kind of fart into the seat. But those like kind of pleathery ones, bounces right off and goes right to the next person's nose.
The question I have is, why would somebody want to go as far as to try to hide something that everybody does?
Yeah, everybody should enjoy it.
That's right.
Everybody poops. Everybody farts.
Masturbate on a metal or on a stone floor.
You think maybe there should be like an announcement?
Blow
like
your nose.
Anything.
The farmers blow here and there. You know,
whatever's got to get done.
I mean, if you're gonna be that open about it, you think there should be an announcement before or after? Like, hey, I'm about to fart. You know, like everybody.
Yeah, warning.
And then people can gather around. People that are into it can be like, oh, this is gonna be great.
But that is definitely one way to go about it. But my favorite part is the people watch afterwards.
I love to try to be discreet.
That's right. I love the response.
Like, I ate 6 pounds of meat today. You're gonna want to come over and check this one out.
So if we're sitting on the plane next to each other and you've already caught it a few times, right? And
it starts to smell like a bathroom. You're just like, oh my God, where am I?
And all of a sudden you see me go like this.
He's waving the air behind his neck.
The first one is for me. I'm throwing it over the seat for the people behind us.
I think if I was on a plane with you, I'd fucking roll down the window. I'd just rather have the risk, you know? Like, excuse me, I gotta I gotta roll this shit down.
We just did 20 minutes on farts.
We got another hour to go.
We're just talk that much starting. About poop yet.
Yeah.
Oh, I love it.
Oh, man. So it's not 10 farts per shart anymore. You're telling me the whole mathematical scheme has changed.
It's been thrown off.
Well, so it's kind of here's the thing. So let's just pretend that you're, and this is I'm winging this, so forgive the analogy here, but if let's just say that you're a jet fighter pilot and you have weapons on your plane and you've got a machine gun and you've got an atomic bomb.
Okay. I like where this is going.
So the question you got to ask yourself, are you going to count how many rounds you fire off?
No, there's too many, huh?
Once you drop an atomic bomb, how many rounds you fire doesn't make a difference anymore.
Irrelevant. Yeah, makes sense.
So, you know, it's like it's like you finally found the switch to open the hatch to drop that bomb. The guns are just kind of an afterthought.
What was the name of that book you wrote again?
I feel like the Gandhi of poop.
I gotta reread this thing.
Yeah, maybe we call it Deep Cheeks. You know, that's shit, man. I didn't even think about that.
Everybody Poops other. Part Two. Deep Cheeks.
Water by Deep Cheeks.
Yeah. That's good.
Yeah, people always hashtag Deep Cheeks whenever funny. I post something on
it. I know it.
Mr. Deep Cheeks.
That's it. You know, that's a great test of if you've been working your posterior chain. If you shart and you save your underpants, as Mike said, you save money on Tide.
Yeah, you know? It's true.
That's it.
And you save yourself some shame.
Squats have saved the day.
Yeah.
That's it.
John was posing earlier for some pictures with his shirt off, and we could see that he actually has a second butt way above his actual butt.
Oh, yeah. What's going on with that thing?
That's all the years of the benefit of strength training. You know, the density of my, I guess it's not really lower, it's kind of mid back.
Yeah, yeah. Something like erectors or some shit.
Yeah, well, it's ultimately, and it really works out to be a great pose for me, you know, in the regards of how is everybody's back are so unique. But it gives me I have that lower lat development. And you can really see that Christmas tree. So what you guys were seeing was the depth of it's right over the top of my spine.
Yeah, it's fucking
but
nuts.
Terry actually, she actually tests it. She'll put me sideways in the mirror, and she puts so if I'm standing like this, and the mirror's over here, she puts her hand in like this.
And your back crack.
And she can get like her fingers will disappear in there.
She can go four fingers deep on you.
Sounds she like can. We have a someone and to fix a hemorrhoid.
I think I know where the hemorrhoid is.
Well,
coming
I was gonna say, because now what's gonna happen? I'm gonna say, honey, check my back. And she's gonna go like this. And I'm yeah.
Whoops. Pull a quick one.
Yeah. But, you know, I got to give it to my lady because if I said to her, I said, honey, I need you to put some of that cream on your finger and get it up onto that thing. She'd cut her fingernail and do it for me.
Yeah.
She'd be like, all right,
that's a trooper.
And I might put her in a spot here when I get home.
Yeah.
You know?
Hey, you might have to put her to the test.
Yeah.
Yeah. See where her loyalty is.
I don't doubt she'll do it, too.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
What is that?
Human butt plug.
Upper butt crack from deadlifts?
Yeah. I mean, I think that ultimately what you're seeing is obviously deadlifts, but I think stone training was a huge part of that.
Similar movements.
Largely because when I started strongman, I had a difficulty with getting the technique down. So true to my OCD, I just, when I have difficulties, I just do it and just don't stop. So there was quite a long time where my stone training was a priority in my training, and I would really go over the top with working the technique. So I mean, when you're picking up a stone off the ground, you know, you're not in your lower back is not set. It's not in a good position.
Right.
So you're really
almost supposed to be kind of in a weird position, right?
And, I mean, you
kind of rounded.
You really couldn't go down on a big stone and get set the way that you could. You're supposed to in a deadlift. So
go down on a big stone.
Go down on a big stone.
You know
baby.
What I'm saying?
So I think that largely, I think that that's what we're seeing because that depth is, you know. It's a little different. It's not down on the erectors where you might expect from someone just deadlifting alone, you know? So, but, yeah, I mean, that's kind of the cool thing about, you know, bodybuilding and whatnot is that, you know, everybody's physique is truly unique to what they've done.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, all their different years of training, whether they did gymnastics growing up or football whatever. It's going to manifest itself somewhere, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
You were talking earlier about your waist getting smaller.
Yeah.
The time you've been bodybuilding.
Well, you know, when I came into, you know, when I went from into bodybuilding, obviously, you know, you really don't know what you're gonna look like till you get dieted all the way down.
Right.
And so when I got dieted down for the first time, and I was still a house, but my waist was not. It was not. It didn't give me that illusion that I was looking for to get where I wanted to go. So, I mean, that first contest I did, I mean, I wiped it out. But, you know, once we realized that I was going to take this thing further, you know, when we looked at where I wanted to go, we recognized real quick that, you know, having my waist come down was a big part of that equation. So, you know, now that's a focus on pretty much almost, it's pretty much an everyday focus. I mean,
it's kind of more like your upper mid stomach than it is like your actual like hips, because your hips
are very small. My hip girdle is tight. It's those erectors. And just like you said, that kind of that mid. So there's a couple things that I've done, you know, which was really tough. I mean, I'll tell you, one of the things, I'm just getting a hold of it now, and it's making a big difference. You know, being the forever fat kid, you find those times where eating is comforting,
right?
You know, and I developed my own system of eating to keep myself lean, but that what that really was, it was giving me the ability to eat as much as I wanted, which, you know, sometimes, you know, we've all done it, but I do it a lot, where I'd eat until, you know, I feel distended and kind of look right. pregnant. And that's exactly what, you know, I can't do anymore.
Yeah, you're almost training to make your stomach larger so you can eat more food to fuel what you were doing.
Yes.
You're doing strongman, and you know, the strongman guys, they're huge.
Yeah.
So you had to be 300-plus pounds just to even be close to being competitive. So it makes sense that you were doing that for a long time.
Yeah. And so what, and then, you know, through my wrestling career, you know, it's, I really didn't have any, you know, it's just so different. I didn't have to make any changes, you know, so I just, you know, went about my training the way I love to train and, you know, did my wrestling and yada, yada. But now, ultimately, to shrink my waistline, one of the things that I did, which has been a huge help. So for anybody out there that's trying to have a more svelte figure, this is what you might want to try. So what I do is I map out.
This is very girly, by the way.
I map out my meals in such a way to where I never eat too much at one time. So what I do is like you see here, I'm in the off season, right? But I still have a 6-pack bag here with my meals prepped and ready to go. And what that does is it keeps me from eating too much. And so I eat a minimum 6, maximum 8 times a day, but they're smaller meals. So I'm still getting the same nutrients and the same protein, but I'm not stretching out my midsection.
And now that suddenly makes sense. Like, we've heard all sorts of different reasons why eating 6 to 8 times a day for bodybuilders is the thing to do.
Yeah.
Now it makes sense to me.
Yeah.
Never having so much on board
that
you're distending your gut.
Yeah, yeah. And
I think some guys, too, it's a matter of being able to get the nutrients in throughout the whole day.
Right.
Because if you eat, like, you guys know, like, if you first thing in the morning, if you crush a bunch of pancakes and eggs and bacon and all that stuff, you're not eating again until 2 o'clock.
Yeah, right. You'll wait 5-6 hours before you eat again.
Right.
And you got to have a constant flow of, you know, good nutrients coming in if you want to make these physique changes the way that it's necessary to be successful. And the next thing that I did was really had to do with this was the toughest one is pretty much all the time when you're walking around, when you get out of bed, you have to think about not just letting your gut hang. You know, from a guy who, you know, I got myself to a position from being the fat kid where I was in good shape, and I know that I'm lean. So having my stomach hang a little bit, but having my abs visible, it was okay with me.
Right.
But are you talking like a stomach vacuum type deal?
Kind of.
Like, you know, sucking it in for a photo or something.
Yeah.
You know?
So ultimately what it comes down to is I try to have, like,
you're learning what it's like to be a woman.
That's it.
I think the ladies have to be self-conscious at all time. They're always trying to suck it in.
I have always said from the jump that I am 100% a woman trapped in a man's body.
Uh-oh. We've had that happen here before.
Part 2. Yeah.
What is it about this room?
Yeah.
So what I want to do is I want the front of my abdominal wall to sit even or slightly back of my hip bones.
Yeah.
And so the problem is that it's kind
of
like,
and now it's way out in front of your dick even.
Yeah, right? Where's your dick go?
So anyway, so those are the two things that I really focus on. And then obviously there are a few techniques inside my ab training. Like in strongman and strength training, when you know when you're trying to make your gut strong to support heavy weight, you know, you're doing say a weighted sit up, you're not worried about pulling your abdominal wall back.
Right. Right.
You know, and rolling up over the top of your abdominal wall. You're worried about making that sucker strong. You don't care if it's distended or not. So it's the, you know, that's a, the way that I train my abs are different too in the regards that everything. I think
I'm starting to understand what's going on here. You're training against the grain. Your stomach is supposed to be
no grains, carb free.
Yeah,
well, training that, against the yeah, that, common.
Yeah. Your stomach is naturally kind of distended, and you're trying to suck it in, and that's causing too many problems and too much stress, and now you got hemorrhoids.
It's got to go somewhere.
There it is. Yeah. There, the puzzle is finally pieced together. No. Shit.
I think that's part of it.
Pressure's got to go somewhere.
Yeah. You're lucky it didn't shoot out of somewhere else.
Nah. Hemorrhoid in your wiener.
No, yeah, that would be a story.
Well then.
But yeah, the waist slimming thing is a full-time job. You can't just think about it on ab day.
Right.
You
know,
literally, it's like it's just something that you have to be mindful of all the time.
I think someone would say something similar to like an injury. Like if somebody tears their patella tendon or something like that, and they go to the doctor, and if it's a good doctor, they're going to, you know, teach them the rehab and teach them how to do this and that again. And then they're going to kind of look at the way they stand, look at the way they walk, and say, hey, you know what? Yes, I heard what you said. You tore your patella tendon doing a squat, but you know what? You kind of stand really awkwardly. You walk really awkwardly. And now the conversation is you have to be on 24/7 watch of where your foot is all the time. So a similar thing with what you're talking about with the stomach. Yeah, you're going to have to suck it in a little bit, be a little bit more conscious of it, be a little bit more attached to it so that it's not an issue.
Yeah. And, you know, the cool thing about it is, you know, of course, there, you know, the question is how much of a change can you really make? And so if you go back to, you know, my first contest, you know, if you look at the series of contests that I've done over the last 16 months, you know, the first one to the last one, it was a remarkable difference. It really was. And I really had large questions about how much difference could I make. I really wondered if, you know, like my obliques, my obliques have actually narrowed, and I believe it's because, you know, through, you know, the other stuff we talked about, you know, it's almost like it's all being pulled around versus being pushed out and back, if that makes sense.
Right.
But it's, you know, it's just one of those things, you know, like if you put your mind to something, it's amazing what you can do.
Well, you probably never really trained your stomach for aesthetics before anyway.
No, not like. Not
I mean,
like
maybe when you were a kid and you were first starting out, you did some crunches or something like that. But, you know, now there's like an actual real focus on it. Whereas before you said you'd do like weighted sit-ups or something.
Yeah.
And a workout and just trying to handle something heavy, right?
Yeah, very different. Yeah, it was for performance, not aesthetics. Right. It's just two different, it's black and white.
In strongman, do you have to train your stomach much? I mean, you got the stones and the farmer's walk and the yoke carry. I mean, it just seems like there's kind of a lot of indirect training of the core anyway.
Yeah, I mean, there's no question that you're going to get strong just by training the events. However, you know, most the way it's going to break down is you're not going to train events every day.
Right.
So, you know, on those days where you're not training, you're definitely not going to be doing sit-ups on a day you're doing heavy yoke walks. Or
right.
It's not going to happen. But on a day where you're, you know, maybe you're heavy, you know, squat day or barbell press day, you know, in the gym, that's a perfect opportunity, you know, to get a little bit more, you know, create some more stability in your midsection through, you know, a weighted sit-up or whatever it is that you choose.
What's your training split like now? Before, like you said, you're kind of trying to prefer performance, and you probably would have a lift day. Like we talk, like today's squat day. Today isn't legs day.
Yeah.
So how's that changed mentality-wise, and how's it changed like on paper?
Well, so when I first made these splits, it was designed around trying to bring up body parts to match some other ones. Like my shoulders were strong and my arms weren't quite matching my shoulders, so my arms took a lot of they took a lot of priority in the earlier part of my training, my bodybuilding training. But then because the bodybuilding training is new to me, and when I say new, you know, I've always had bodybuilding in it, but just it's now it's the pure focus,
right?
I was able to bring my arms up to match my shoulders, so now my split is designed more around, you know, overall improvement. So that's so like right now my split is different than it was when I was trying to bring in my arms. So now Monday is going to be quads. As I would have said in the past, squat, you know.
Right.
And then Tuesday is going to be chest and biceps. And the reason I do that is because you're going to get some indirect triceps in that chest workout.
Right.
So it's almost like a secondary tricep workout without actually putting it on the docket, so to speak.
Right.
And Wednesday's off, which I've actually am taking more scheduled days off between training days than I was before, which has been a large help, you know, because the, you know, the bodybuilding training, I mean, I tend to like a lot of volume anyway, but then the bodybuilding training is known to have more volume than the other types than say strength training. So right. My volume is actually a lot. So having that Wednesday off after day three off, which is Wednesday, is great. Then day four, which would be Thursday, goes to posterior chain / hamstrings, which is used to be, I would have said deadlift before, but now I reference it as hamstrings and glutes. Then Friday, which is day five, is shoulders and shoulders and triceps. Yeah, because and then Saturday is back. And then sometimes, depending on how my biceps feel, I may throw a little biceps in with back. So before, biceps was with back for sure because I was trying to bring it up.
Yeah. Right.
So, yeah, and the, you know, the split, obviously, you know, just like everything else, you know, it's a constant evolution. But right now that's where it is, and it's cracking. It's feeling really
good. Yeah, it's interesting. A lot of people have, you know, in powerlifting have changed it, you know, over the years. And I've heard of strong men, you know, changing their split, you know, quite often. But it's kind of a thing that for some reason people kind of think is set. You know, they think it's a set thing that you have to kind of always do and always and always kind of, you know, do it that way. I know some really top-level powerlifters for a long time were doing squats and deadlifts on the same day, and then everyone was like, oh, I need to do it that way. And it's just, like you said, it's going to be something that evolves over a period of time. And maybe it's a good idea to train your deadlift when you already squatted, so you're training in a fatigue state. And maybe it's a good idea to also go through periods of time where your deadlift is the main priority. Yeah. Stuff like that, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. And for that matter, you know, just on what you're saying, to mix it up, you have, you know, maybe you have a, you know, a few weeks where you do them together, then you break them apart, you know, and there's just, and then it, you know, not having things be the same is really the root of what we're talking about here, you know? So
not just wildly changing them, but changing with thought over time and observing what.
I honestly will throw merit on both sides of that fence because I do totally agree with subtle changes. The body will make the body will evolve and get bigger, you know, faster and stronger through subtle changes. But there are those times where you just feel like you're kind of against a brick wall. So in those scenarios, I'll just think of the fucking goofiest thing that I can think of and just attack it. And just blow it out and try. It's almost like just trying to shake it loose.
Yeah. You know? Well, that's kind of stuff keeps you interested too.
Yeah.
You know, 100%. Which breaks things up.
Mark and I were talking about that. You know, part of the challenge of this industry and surviving in this industry and for the long haul, you know, like myself, almost 30 years, is staying motivated to, you know, there's no question that we hear the term, this is a marathon, right?
Right.
But every time you show up to the gym, you have to treat that workout like a sprint because, I mean, how the hell do you stay motivated with the marathon mentality on a daily basis?
Yeah.
You got to keep that marathon mentality when you're talking about sleep and meal prep and all that shit. But when it comes to kicking ass in the gym, it's a fucking 100-meter deal.
Yeah.
You know?
That makes sense. Yeah, deep water. We're running a marathon and a fucking sprint.
That's right. That's right. God right? damn it. That's
we're doing
right.
both.
That's it.
No, I agree with that. And that's, you know, we've heard a lot of statements like that over the years. You know, you got Louis Simmons who, you know, would teach, you know, working on your form and working on your speed on one day.
Yeah.
You know, where that's a day where it's practice and it's refinement. And you have another day where you're going all out. You're going nuts.
Yeah.
I've heard Max Aida, who's an Olympic lifting athlete and now Olympic lifting coach and a powerlifter. And
he's right by me.
Yeah, right. Yeah, you know him. And one of his coaches said to him, you know, lift it perfectly or lift it whatever way you can.
You're talking about Goff.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, that's like, you know, that's sums it up. Like, yes, you should work on doing the lift the right way and doing it correctly. But there's also a time where you just got to fucking throw down.
Yeah.
Right. There's a time where you got to be competitive and actually compete and actually strive to, you know, push the envelope.
Yeah. I mean, if your technique goes awry, you don't fucking bail out on the goddamn lift.
Right.
You find
right.
a way to get it done. And next time you try to do it with a little better technique, you know?
Right. Yeah, maybe for that day you do a 405 deadlift and it looked like shit, and then you work on doing 315 for a few sets afterwards, the fact.
And tighten that technique down, absolutely. Right. Yeah, 100%.
What would you say is like the strongest case for a strongman? You know, if you do think that there is, what do you think is a strong case for just people in general and athletes to utilize strongman training?
Well, I think that the one thing...
Or some form of it.
Yeah, I think that the thing about strongman training that anybody can benefit from is it is functional strength, man. I mean, like, let's use picking a stone.
And you would say, I mean, how would you define functional strength? Maybe just kind of like in terms of it just overall body development and just training your whole body within one given movement kind of thing?
So let's jump back to me. We're talking about that stone. So that the stone, you bend over, we talked about a little while ago.
And you're in a perfect position to fart.
Yeah. Yeah.
You're in the fart position.
You go to pick that thing up, you're rounded back. You know, you look like a humping dog. You know what I mean? You see a dog, he gets that rounded back. Yeah. You know, you're not in a good position, and when it comes
you just
to
gave Silent Mike a boner. It's the first one he's
broke
had.
Our table.
It's the first one he's had in 3 years.
Listen, I've been trying to entice him to get that freaking figure out all day. I was thinking working. The humping dog thing might have perked his interest.
Yeah, the humping chihuahua gets me.
But you know, let's say that you're helping your grandma move, you know, and she's got, you know, some piece of furniture that's heavy. You're not going to be getting down to pick this thing up like you would a deadlift. You're going to be bent over. It's going to be away from you. It's going to be
awkward.
You're out of position. Yeah, 100% awkward. And that's what all these movements of strongman.
Strongman stone like, would help you to lift anything because it's weird.
And that's the functional part of it. So
it's more like real work.
Yes. So like a deadlift is great. It helps you become strong.
Yeah.
But you're going to perform to that level only with a bar.
Right.
Versus if you're lifting up a 400-pound stone, it's very feasible you could lift up a 400-pound something else that, you know, is not a stone.
Right.
You know? So I think the function of strongman can benefit anybody, you know?
Do you have a lot of people at your facility? You have your own gym now, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where's your gym at?
Right in Novato. It's beautiful. It's about less than 2 miles from my house, so the commute kills me.
Kind of a personal training studio type thing.
Yeah, so it's basically not open to the public. Not to say that you have to be some world destroyer of an athlete to come there. As I tell everybody that comes in the door, because everybody has to kind of come and meet me, and we decide, you know, how they're going to fit or where they're going to fit. And I tell everybody the same thing: you are judged on your effort, not your ability. Mm. Because you know, if the guy's giving it up,
attitude over technique.
That's right.
That's the same key we give about women giving blowjobs. Attitude over technique.
Or maybe that'll work with my hemorrhoid.
I'm sure it will. It's all about the attitude, less technique.
But anyway, so you know, it's you know, we do have strongman there, you know. Mm-hmm. That's one of the it's a Sunday course that I run. And you know, for the people in my group, myself, people I competed with, and I actually can think of a handful of you know, very accomplished powerlifters and even, you know, Olympic lifters that have come from other sports to strongman. You know, stayed for a number of years, done well, gone back to their original sport, and were substantially stronger because of what we're talking about. You know, let's just say that you got a, you know, you're doing a max deadlift and you get pulled a little forward and you're out of position. It's not going to be quite so foreign when you've been lifting stones for the last 2 years.
Right.
You know, you'll know how to battle off the balls of your feet back onto your heels a little better, or, you know, whether you know how to battle or you just are more comfortable with being out of position.
Right. And these stones aren't perfect. I mean, some of these, some of the guys I know, they're throwing like plates and stuff
into
cement and just doing whatever they can to make these stones weigh a certain amount of weight. And so like one side of the stone may weigh 150 pounds and the other side only weigh 100.
Yeah.
And you go to pick it up and the thing wants to flip flop away from you.
Absolutely. You know, and then there's the whole part of it that, you know, holding on to it is a whole other deal. It's not like grabbing a bar.
Yeah.
You know, there's definitely some toughness associated with it, doesn't 100%. It? I mean, it breaks up your skin.
Oh, yeah.
Right? It's
100%. So
scraping you up.
So from the standpoint of you know, strongman, you know, bringing, you know, function to regular people or even powerlifters or any athlete, it is 100% there. You see, like stars in the NFL flipping tires. Yeah. Yeah. What's the guy from the Texans, Watt?
J.J. Watt.
Oh, yeah, yeah. He crushes these big tires. And look at the guy. He just
a mutant.
He just annihilates.
Oh, yeah. What was the tire? He was flipping something huge.
It was over 1,000 pounds.
I was in the elevator.
Yeah, and people were like, that's not 1,000. People were flipping out because he was doing it so easy.
Yeah.
And it's like, well, maybe he's just on another level.
No, he's a mutant. I was at a Fit Expo a couple months ago in L.A., and it was the same weekend of the ESPYs, and I was staying at the same hotel as all the athletes. So I'm getting in the elevator. J.J. Watt starts coming out. I mean, his stats say he's whatever, 6'4", 280 or something. He was the biggest motherfucker I've seen that close. Like
here's what people have to realize is that there are plenty of people who you take a crack, say, at the NFL. You know, they get their shot, they don't make it, and then they go into another, like an underground sport, right? Say like strongman. But you don't get a guy like J.J. Watt, who's a fucking star in the NFL, come cross over to strongman.
Right.
So how would we make a comparison to that? Right. You know, we that guy's too good to come to strongman.
With your eye, what would you say that tire weighs?
I've actually had a tire just like that, so I can personally verify that is right about it. Part of those tires is the fact that how much tread is left. The tire that I had was worn all the way down, and I had a weight. It was like 845. Tire,
so maybe a little bit more.
That tire is
new.
Is not nearly as worn down. Yeah. And 150 pounds of tread weight is nothing, because let me tell you, that is dense rubber, dude. Yeah, dense
that thing
rubber,
like a little baby.
Yeah, I mean that literally is the same exact tread as my the training tire that I had, and I had it weighed at 845. And
well, you know, a forgotten element of strength is athleticism. You know, like that guy moves really well. So as you talked about being in an awkward position, you know, and I know like there's some cases against being like muscle bound, and obviously you disproved theories like that many times over, but. When you are overly muscular, shit's just in your way. J.J. Watt is tall. He's got long arms. He's going to be able to grab a stone
Have you seen his body? He's on the cover of ESPN magazine.
Oh, my
God. Hey, now.
Hey.
Well, you know, the thing about it, too, is that, you know, he's
dropping down in a nice position.
He's cross-training here. So it's not like he has someone who's ultra-experienced with flipping a tire.
Right.
You know, somebody showed him how to some extent, but he's really not doing it in the terms of becoming a better tire for the look at his feet. He's starting off with his feet staggered, much like he would in a stance. So he's doing it with the intent of being the best tire flipper. He's using it to literally help him become a better defensive lineman. So you take a guy like that and you coach him up, it would be a whole different world.
Yeah, you have no idea what happened. Yeah. I've always said that too with powerlifting, you know, and Louis Simmons, again, referencing him, has said powerlifting is a sport for the rest of us, meaning like we weren't good enough to do anything else, and we fucking ended up here. You know, we settled for this sport because we weren't good enough for football, basketball, baseball, that kind of stuff, you know?
Yeah, 100%. So if you get a guy like this, you know, if an athlete like this was ever to, let's just say he somehow decided it was his life's dream to retire from the NFL and become a strong, this guy would, you know, he would cause some serious trouble because here's a guy who's making that tire look easy, and he's not even doing it. I mean, he obviously is doing it well, but he's not really even doing it to make it the most efficient tire flip. Yeah.
And I guess you got like, you know, maybe Brian Shaw is close to that in the sense that he, I think he was Division I basketball player, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Right? And he's like 6'8". And
Thor played international pro basketball, I believe, for a little bit.
That wouldn't surprise me at all.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, so they're top, but that's still not the NBA and NFL.
Yeah. Right, right. Yeah. Yeah.
They're not the top.
Yeah, you always wonder, like, what would LeBron James do?
Yeah.
You know, like, if he just decided to do any, I don't know, whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah, 100%. I mean, let's be honest. I mean, when you can do some sort of an athletic event and get paid millions of dollars versus not, what are you going to do?
Right. Yeah. You know, for being as jacked as you are, you were extremely athletic as well. I mean, you were always trying to implement some of the Olympic lifting movements.
Yeah.
Even when you were doing strongman, and even when you weighed well over 300 pounds, you're still doing cleans and snatches. Is that right?
Yeah, 100%. I mean, when I when I went into
that's pretty unconventional. I don't think I've really heard of a lot of strongman athletes using the Olympic lifts. I mean, I know you got a clean to worry about sometimes in a strongman.
Was it a continental clean or something?
Continental is the most common one, you know. Right. So the regular clean is not a staple. But what happened was when, as a lot of my story, I get from being an unknown to getting onto a pretty major stage quickly. Mm-hmm. So in essence, I kind of have some catch up work to do on the specific techniques, if you will.
Right.
And so basically I just completely immersed myself with trying to, I need to be a better strength athlete from every perspective I can. So Yasha Fay, who's the head trainer at my facility, he was also my Olympic weight training coach. He did a stint about 5 years in the Olympic Training Center in Colorado Springs. So he was trained by the best. And so anyway, having fast, powerful hips is a staple for any sport.
Yeah.
And so the Olympic lifts that's all you're doing is harnessing the hip power. And so I basically, when I laid out my split for my strongman days, is I had a designated Olympic training day and Olympic weightlifting training day. And it was a huge help. And it really helped me develop, not only really fast hips, but and powerful hips. The whole thing was sparked by the stone. Remember, I was telling you a hard time with the stone, and I was having a hard time sending my hips in quickly enough. And I was like, okay, well, I got to get, I need to get some help here. And that's where Yasha came in. But going outside the box has always been, that's been me. That's deep water. I have lots of respect for the people that have done great things. And I use that for motivation and inspiration for sure. But I've always felt that, you don't get where you want to go by playing follow the leader.
Right.
And I would rather turn over some stones and maybe not find what I'm looking for than just go to the well, that I know, there's something there, but is it really going to be that lightning in a bottle? I'm always in search of the lightning in the bottle, so to speak, And, we talked about motivation. I think that's part of it, always looking for that. It's almost like you're playing blackjack and you're always waiting for that next blackjack to hit the table, And, if you know you're going to have 17s, for the next 10 years, it's pretty fucking boring.
It's hard to hit on 17.
God damn.
God damn. Any new poop stories? We talked about shards, but like a real poop story. I mean, bodybuilding, your diet may be a little different. Cardio. Things are a little different nowadays.
Well, I think the one that probably has caught me the most by surprise was, we talked about this ties into the waist slimming. Mm-hmm. Right? So, I have this protocol that I developed to keep myself regular. The closer I get to the contest, the harder it is to stay regular. At the end, I'm using Metamucil 3 times a day. I'm taking like huge amounts of stool softeners.
We have like almost a 1-to-1 ratio with your eating and your pooping, right? Like 6 meals and 6 poops, right?
Yeah, 6 poops a day?
Pretty close.
That's impressive.
I mean, in a lot of times, if I'm in a slight calorie surplus or a major one for that matter, what comes in, I'm gonna get some to go out, but if I'm not in a surplus, I don't get that. So,
yeah, pro bodybuilder Alberto Nunez told us at the end of his towards stepping on stage, his shits turned into rabbit pellets.
Oh fuck, man, I would die for a rabbit
pellet. Still shooting rockets.
What happens is, I have just this, dust, this protocol. Just dust blowing out. Of trying to keep myself regular, and then right at the end. Like the last couple of days, I feel like taking in the fiber doesn't help me because it bloats you. Mm-hmm. Right. So I continue to take my stool softener, but then even at some point I have to stop taking that because I've got sodium. You got to block sodium. Mm-hmm. Anyway, so this last contest, even though I was very, very pleased with the progress I made with slimming my waist, right? Remember I told you the last contest when I had dinner with Terry and had some food, my body started to relax because it had some food and some calories I hadn't had in a long time. So I get back up to the room and I'm like, oh man, I feel the stir. I got a dump coming, right? So I sit down and, you know, it starts coming out. Oh, good. This is cool. You know, and it smells like it's been in there for a while. Anyway, so.
Been brewing.
You sit there, you get that first wave, and then you sit there a little while longer and you're waiting for the little tickle or the rumble. You're going to get another one. Well, usually you do. Boom, there goes the second one. Okay, cool. Shit, man. I'll just browse my Instagram for, let's see if I'm going to get a third. It's coming a couple days, so I'm taking a dump, right? All of a sudden, God damn it, here we go again. Boom, there's the next one. I'm like, open my legs up, look down. Oh, holy shit. I'm like, honey, you got to come take a look at this, you know? Anyway,
this is unbelievable.
So long and short of it, I ended up having five, maybe six waves. I mean, this was, it looked like
a
someone.
Tsunami.
It looked like someone took a garbage can of crap and dumped it in the toilet. I mean, it was like, you know, we've all had those turds that haystacks up out of the water, right? This thing was like, there was no water. It was just, this pot of stew. Dude.
Yeah.
It was pretty, it was like.
Were you kind of in disbelief? Like, I can't even believe that I did that came out of my body.
Well, you know, honestly, I was thinking to myself, if I had my waist look slimmer with all that in me,
yeah, really.
I got to do a better job of figuring out how to get that out of me.
you need a colonics or something like that. Yeah,
yeah, oh. You know, that's it.
Yeah. Not bad. Maybe they can fix that hemorrhoid.
Yeah.
Like, God, Jon Andersen only weighs 180.
I didn't even think about that because I was.
You're full of shit, Jon.
Yeah, literally. Yeah, it was. You know, because you think at the end, you know, you're not eating a ton. So I really had, at that point, I believe, before I had this freaking, you know, this pot of stew sitting underneath me, I really had believed at that point that I was using what I was taking in. I didn't realize that there was so much waste that was just sitting in there, you know?
Turning you into a Hawaiian volcano.
That's disgusting.
Yeah, it was.
Building an island in your toilet.
Yeah, I mean, it was definitely, you know, it all, the smells that I was putting out downstairs in the restaurant, everybody thought there was something stinky on the floor. So it all made sense after that because what was coming out of me was off the chain stanky, you know.
Damn.
But I got to give it to my lady, you know. You know, when I tell her she's got to come take a look, she comes take a look.
At least fakes to be interested.
Yeah. Well, whether she's
she proud or disgusted.
I think she just kind of does it and because I've asked her to do it, I don't know that she really forms an opinion on it. You know, because if she doesn't come, like, come on, I'll just keep riding. Come on, get in here. You know, and I'll tell her finally, say, look, you got two choices. You can look voluntarily or you can look non-voluntarily.
Yeah, you'd be surprised.
You have to come back in this room at some point.
Oh, my God.
So you've done professional wrestling, you've done professional strongman, now professional bodybuilding. What were the highs and lows of each one of those for you to this point?
Well, the first thing when you say that, the probably the low comes out first, and it was low, but also a very really intense learning phase. So it was positive at the same time. But probably what was toughest in the whole thing was, you know, you have a hard time walking away from something or being asked to leave for that matter. You know, so I was really pleased with you know, with what was going on with me in my job in New Japan, and then just the way it kind of works, all of a sudden they just don't renew you. They just don't call you back. And so that was tough because, you know, it's like, it's almost like you don't see it coming, or maybe you think that it's, you're going to get it. You keep thinking you're going to get a year out of the deal. I mean, I was 41 at the time, so I knew the knock on the door was coming, you know, but that was pretty tough, you know, but then, I also went through I did some soul searching and I learned a lot through that experience too. So, you know, at the time it was brutal and it was hard for me to handle, but it was also a really positive thing. And then, you know, through that turned into obviously my bodybuilding career.
Yeah. And you mentioned to me, you know, when you were wrestling, You know, got some injuries and stuff like that, and then you ended up getting hooked on some pain medication and stuff.
Yeah.
Did them not renewing your contract and stuff like that, did that help you to get off stuff because maybe you weren't traveling as much and maybe you weren't as much pain, or the two things almost completely unrelated?
Yeah, because by the time that by the time I was not renewed, I there was no substance issue anymore. Oh, okay. There was no cross up there. But, that's another low time too, because, as we talked about, yesterday, you don't realize that's the, what makes that shit so deadly is you don't realize you got a problem until you try to get off that shit.
Yeah. And it's got you by the throat.
Yeah. I hang my hat on being a disciplined motherfucker and all this stuff. And so I was able to fight my way out of that. But it was really sad for me to watch some of the people I was close with in two different, sports I was in. I haven't yet to see it in bodybuilding. I hope that I don't, but I'm sure I will. Where, people's careers, and even worse than that, their lives get taken from them because of the fucking substance.
Yeah.
I mean, like in strongman, of course, I'm not going to mention any names, but, there was, a few people, one specifically, used to come and train me, stay at my house. We traveled a ton. And, I wouldn't even know where to find him right now.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah, I mean, it's sad. It's really sad, and
they make you a different, drugs can make you a different person.
Yeah, and that was part of it, too, is that, right at the tail end of, before, he went kind of underground, so to speak, it was everybody else's fault. And I was like, God, it's so different.
Yeah. What's wrong with this
person? Accountability gets completely lost.
Yeah.
That can be very telltale of an addiction problem is that suddenly everything is somebody else's fault.
Yeah, 100%. You want to help, but at the same time, there's only so much help you can give somebody that doesn't want it.
Right. Yeah. Well, and you got your own life to live and you got your own problems, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it sounds cold, but that's the truth of it.
Yeah. Yeah. So that was, those were, definitely some low times, but the thing about that at the same time is that, those are my choices, like the one that was probably the toughest was I tore my bicep off in a wrestling match and had to come home to get that fixed. And then I only had 6 weeks from the time I got home until the time I had to go back to Japan, which is not enough. My surgeon was like, you don't even have your goddamn brace off, And I was assuming I had the surgery the day I was having the consultation.
Which never happens.
But I told him, I said, look, this is what I'm doing, And it wasn't like I was being forced to do it. It's, living my dream. I was doing what I wanted to do. I was, and it's like I wasn't going to be denied what I've worked so hard for. And by the time I had the surgery, went through the rehab, went back, did my tour, and came home, it was north of 12 weeks, and I'd been on, and they prescribed me Oxycontin, which is just the brutalest one.
Yeah.
You don't realize how fucked you are until you go to try to get off that shit, And by the end, because I was in the beginning, of course, it's prescribed and you're using it just to deal with the hurdles that you've got. And then obviously it becomes less and less effective. So you have to keep taking more and more. And, by the end, my feet hit the ground, I would wake up. I had the pill sitting out by the bedside. I would take an 80 milligram of this Oxycontin, which is huge. It's a huge amount, and that would just be the first dose of the day to kind of put me square so I could go about my way. And, it's like you go from that first dose of 10 milligrams, all of a sudden you're rolling over an 80 and like, how the hell did I get here?
Yeah.
And it's brutal, And then, then like in the wrestling world, when someone gets hurt and they've got a drug like this, everybody and their freaking brother's your best friend all the time because everybody wants it.
Right.
And so finally,
it's passed around and it's kind of joked about a lot.
Yeah. And it's like, there's a few times where I'd give a few away, just fucking leave me alone.
Right.
It's not like some of these dudes were even taking them orally, they're crushing them up and snorting them.
Yeah.
It's, You know, there's a lot of substance abuse in that, in the entertainment, you know, sports entertainment.
And, you know, when you're at the beginning of taking stuff like that in the situation you're in, you're doing it for a reason. You're doing it like, okay, this is my livelihood right now, and so I'm continuing my livelihood because without it, I don't think I could. And then it becomes such an integral part of it. And
yeah, you also now the pill is just so you can feel normal.
Right.
It's not to deal with them. I mean, of course, the pain is part of the deal, but you're doing it so you don't fucking throw up and so you don't shit your pants.
Right.
Yeah. You know?
Exactly.
Where was the hemorrhoid when I needed it, you know? But those were tough times for sure. When I'm in the middle of it, you know, it was really tough. I mean, there were times where, you know, you get, you know, there were times where I would just, you know, you just kind of get so mixed up. I mean, you know, mentally, emotionally, the whole deal. I mean, it was my choice and I was doing what I wanted, but, you know, it didn't stop me from, you know, sitting on the foot of the bed and just, you know, I can remember a few times, it's almost like I just would get so pent up, you know, on all levels, you know, just like a 3 to 4, 5 minute hard cry. And all of a sudden it was like, you know, somehow I felt like I had somehow leveled myself out again. That's just how mixed up you are.
It's like the bubble bursts for
I mean, you hear people, they call it the silent scream, you know, where they're just, it's like they're crying for help but they're not really crying for help. You know. But here again, you know, I'll throw it back to you know, deep water. I mean, deep water's me. Deep water is about, you know, forward progress and reaching your goals. And so when I really needed to have that fallback and that discipline, and I need to get off this shit to move forward, I was able to do it. And I really do, you know, the discipline that I've developed through my philosophy of deep water was an integral part of me kicking this, you know.
And it may have been what had you started it too, though, because, because, you know,
I wouldn't have been there without
it. Anything at all costs, right? Yeah. I mean, you're trying to win, basically, is kind of the gist of it.
Yeah.
And you're not necessarily always thinking so clearly. You're like, oh, this is what I want to do. All right, well, I need to take that to do it. All right, you know, and then you're in deep shit, you know, basically.
Yeah. I mean, it's very much what you said. I mean, that one of the things that it's, I guess when I say this, you got to kind of look at both sides of the fence. It was blessed. But then also that blessing can become a little bit of a liability. Yeah. When I explain what I'm going to say next is that from the time I was very little, I knew what I wanted. I mean, I knew that I wanted to be this big, strong dude. And, you know, I would see, it could be a football player, a wrestler. It didn't make a difference what the person did. If they were this big, strong dude, it could have been a woman for that matter. Mm-hmm. I was just completely enthralled. And I knew that's what I wanted. And like you said, Mark, I was going to get there no matter what.
Right.
And, you know, on that level, you know, it's great. It allowed me to do what I'm doing. I mean, I love my life. But at the same time, it's also presented a lot of challenges I've had to work through. You know? But that's life. I mean, if you think that you're going to have something really good without a really bad to match it looming somewhere, you're out of your fucking mind.
Right.
Because there is no free lunch.
Yeah.
I mean, you see it all the time.
Look at just anybody who's great. You got Peyton Manning. You got Tom Brady. You got Bill Belichick. Like any of these guys in football, LeBron James, Kobe Bryant, you know, just any of these guys, they all look like they present themselves in some different ways, right? Mm-hmm. But they're all very tunnel vision. They're all very focused.
Absolutely.
And I'm sure they hurt some fucking feelings along the way because they are so into what they're doing. Maybe some more than others, you know, but I'm sure that there's a lot of pain and a lot of bad shit that kind of has gone with all the greatness.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, you can't get yourself to, you know, to these, you know, heights without being a selfish motherfucker. It just doesn't work.
You have to have
a support group that is willing to accept that,
right?
You know, because like you said, you end up hurting. If people are not willing to accept it and you force them through it, it really hurts them,
right?
You know, and you know, obviously it's not fair to you know, you don't intend to hurt somebody, you know. And obviously there are plenty of times where selfishness blinds you and you do hurt somebody. And even when you have a support group that's willing to go through it, sometimes you push it a little too hard and you got to step back and you know, pay homage to the support they give you on a slightly, you know, more intense level. So they recognize that you see the support and that you recognize it and you're appreciative because, you know, let's be honest. I mean, myself, for example, you know, Terry, the support that she's given me in the last 10 years, you know, I couldn't have done what I've done without her supporting me. Right. No way. I mean, just from the simple standpoint of, I couldn't have kept my home life together with my family and my daughters had I not had her willing and ready to pick up my slack when I was gone. I'd be gone for sometimes, you know, a couple months at a time.
Right.
You know? So, you know, the old saying behind, you know, every great man, there's a great woman. There's some truth to that. Right? I suppose if you're a gay motherfucker, there's a you got a great man behind you.
Yeah, I got Silent Mike.
Great little man.
But before this thing's over, he's going to get my hemorrhoid.
All joking aside, we're going to get this thing fixed. Don't worry.
How are you able to, you know, get off the drugs other than just, you know, willpower? Whatever, because not work for everybody.
I went through with the OxyContin. I went through that twice. I went through that with the bicep, and half of that was at home when I was rehabbing, and the other half was when I was gone on tour. And that was probably the toughest part because then you're not held accountable to be that responsible role model.
Right.
That's probably when it was the darkest. You know, then when I came home and I'm with my support group and I had to get off it, it was still tough, but it's different. When I went through with my back surgery, I was at home the whole time, you know, and so that was definitely. And I remember even it was a holiday went through part of my recovery, and my mom came to visit, you know, and I'm a mama's boy through and through. I love my mom, you know, and I remember she's sitting on the couch next to me, and you know, she said, you know, are you going to be okay? Are you going to be okay to get off this? And I looked at her. I said, Mom, I've got the discipline to do it. Mm. And she looked at me.
So you had a conversation with her?
Yeah.
About it. Okay,
yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, I mean, with the
back. Did you open up to other people about it, or was it mainly kind of her?
You know, it's funny, you know, I kind of, and we even talked about this with my training years ago, I kind of isolate myself.
Yeah.
You know, I don't have, I mean, I'm blessed to have some really good people around me and some really good friends, and my loyalty to them is what keeps my friends close to me. But I don't even see a lot of my good friends a lot because and they all know this about me. If they're not doing what I'm doing, I don't see it. I don't talk to them a lot.
You're right.
So I did open up to the people that are around me, you know, but because the people that are in my circle, so to speak, I don't like to hold things back. Mm. You know, I like to be open. Anyway, point of being is that, like, when my mom was there for holidays and my family was there, being open actually with that, because I'll be honest, you know, I would never, you know, my mom is also a worry ward. I would never say something to her that would make her feel upset or sick.
Right.
You know? So I when I was telling her that I was going to be okay getting off that, it was almost like me putting the stamp on what I had to do.
Right.
That makes sense. Now
you were making yourself accountable.
I had to be accountable to what I told her.
Right.
You know, and that was what made the part with the back surgery easier when I was home with my family, because I said, look, guys, this is what I'm going to do. You know, and you know, if you can't, if your family can't count on you, there's something wrong.
Right.
You know? So, you know, it was, that was the second gone. So I would say for sure being with my support group made that a whole different
deal. Just your family, basically.
Yeah, 100%. You know, and to be honest, I mean, we've done, you know, plenty of interviews and podcasts and stuff, and I've chose to avoid these topics.
Right.
Largely just because, you know, it's personal, but as I grow older and more mature, I realize that, you know, talking about this stuff, if I can help, if there's one person out there listening that this helps, then this was a complete win. You know,
yeah, everybody struggles with something, even if it's just having trouble, you know, putting down the Ben and Jerry's. You know?
Yeah, I've been there too.
Yeah, everyone's got something going on.
Yeah, yeah, but I think the. I thank my lucky stars for, you know, for the discipline and you know, what's allowed me to get through some of this. But, you know, the most heartbreaking thing I think probably is watching some of the people that I love not make it out.
Right.
You know, it's brutal. You
yeah.
know?
Luckily for yourself, it sounds like it was a fairly quick transaction of, you know, 3 months is not that long. And maybe it was just short enough to where you're able to still have everything together enough and have enough great things still around you. Mm-hmm. You know, where some people get into it much earlier, or they get into it and maybe they don't have the responsibility of children or other responsibilities mm-hmm. that they need. That makes them realize early enough that they need to get the fuck yeah. out of that bad yeah. situation that they're in.
And then they start, you know, your life starts to crumble and you run back to the drug for comfort.
Yeah.
You know, and so it's kind of like there's definitely a balance. You know, you see people's lives start to go downhill, and rather than stand up and be more disciplined, they go the other direction, and they, you know, they come. I mean, with food, I used to have a place to do it all the time.
Yeah.
You know, I feel bad if something bad happened at school. Fuck, give me a Snickers.
So what about high points? What are the biggest, the highest highs?
High points. So, in all of three of my careers, you know, I've been, you know, really, really, I've gotten from being an unknown to being on a pretty, you know, I guess you'd say an international playing field pretty quickly. Mm-hmm. So that's been, you know, that's been really cool as in terms of making transitions from one venue to the next quickly. But I think the high points in doing so, Strongman, when I got my pro card, was special.
Uh-huh.
And that actually, there was that day that I got my pro card, I actually set a record for the deadlift, which still stands. And I hope it stands for a while. Nobody's gotten close to it, as I understand it. 500 pounds, 60 seconds, 21 reps.
Wow.
Remember we were talking about that second butt cheek I got? I think that had something to do with it.
That might have been part
so
of it.
So that was a sweet deal, for sure. And then in Strongman, is it because you also too, you know, then when you get onto, you know, anybody that's competed on a high level, international level, you recognize, you know, how difficult it is to pull victories off.
Yeah.
You know, so once you get into, I mean, if you just kind of stay as a national player, you can grab victories, you know, fairly often mm-hmm. if you're good. But you go to the big time, if you can pull off like in my Strongman career, fuck, I only had one. I was only a champion one day as an international player, right. One win out of, you know, 7 years, you know, and that was, I would say that was those two are the strong men right there as uh-huh. far as the heights, you know, and the funny thing is, you know, a lot of times you don't recognize what's happened, and I wish that I had smelled the roses a little more on those 2 days.
That's hard to do, though.
Yeah, it totally is, because I'm not a big. I really only reflect on my failures, not my successes.
Right. I think that's a lot of us. We're so self-critical that we have a hard time enjoying it. Plus, you don't know that, like, okay, this is going to be the time.
Yeah. Well, you think there's another one coming around the corner, and then fuck, man, you bust your ass for the next 5 years, and Jesus Christ, this is harder than I thought. You know. So those two for Strongman. Wrestling would have been when I think it was 2010 or 11. My tag team partner and I from New Japan, Nanabu Nakanishi, and I won the tag team of the year. That was pretty sweet, because the other tag teams that were up for nomination, one of them was actually, they had been setting records on title defenses. Oh, so, okay. But it was just the fact that it largely, you know, it was kind of funny. What made us so popular was the sounds that I made.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
That's
like,
great.
Like, you know, there's, you know, like I would, you know, like when you start moving around and you all of a sudden your blood temperature goes up. Like for me, I start getting gassy. I start burping and farting, as you know. Right?
Oh, weird.
So, natural reaction.
So, you know, my partner was, you know, he'd been in New Japan and been a champion. So he was always the second to go. I always led the matches off. So I'd go out there, do my high spot, da-da-da, get a good sweat up, tag him in, climb out of the ropes. All of a sudden, I'd start burping, you know, burp, you know. And he's out there working his ass off. Boom, boom, boom. And the crowd's quiet, right? And then I let a big burp. Everybody blows up. you know,
and like so, Shrek.
That's great. And so, anyway, they just ate it up, man. The sports writers just loved it, or whatever you call the people that report on this stuff. And so, you know, we got this award, and you know, accompanied with a beautiful plaque and a trophy and a nice bonus. You know, and the coolest thing about it was it just came out of nowhere,
right?
You know, and so it was completely unexpected. Mm-hmm. You know, so that was probably you know, that was definitely a high point in wrestling. And then,
do you have a Ribera Steakhouse jacket?
I do.
Yeah, there you go. So yeah. Mine's purple.
Mine's silver.
No, there we go.
Yeah. No, that's cool. I mean, that's a perfect example. I mean, when you become recognized enough, you go into a restaurant there and they give you a meal.
Right.
They give you a jacket. That's pretty awesome, man.
Yeah, they give you a what kind of, it's like a satin jacket, right?
Yeah.
They're fucking sick. I should show you guys today. I'll bring it in here.
It's like the big puffy, you know. There was a time when this thing was a ball and jacket.
Yeah. Well, it might be time again.
Might have come back around.
Yeah. mine definitely doesn't even come close to fitting either. It didn't fit then and certainly would never fit now.
You know, it's one of those things that you really don't want to wear.
No.
It's just the fact that you got it.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Then in bodybuilding,
hasn't happened yet.
Well, getting my pro card was a
pretty I know, but you got the 2016
Mr.
Right?
Olympia stage.
Mr. Olympia stage.
That's one. That's gonna be the high.
You're gonna make some fucking waves. God damn it!
But you know, there's something about, you know, earning your pro card. There's just, it's like, I don't know, it's like,
yeah, tell me about it. We know, right, guys?
It's like turning a corner, you know. It's like, you know, you've kind of come to the next stage, you know. It's not just a thought anymore, you know. And then I think bodybuilding at this point, the high point is the whole thing, in the regards that I went from an unknown, did my first contest, won my pro card as my second contest show. I'm like one of a couple of people ever do that,
right?
And then having my pro debut, placing top five, all inside of a 16-month period. I think that whole thing is kind of a high point. So it's not one event, but.
And you also said this is like a kind of a lifelong dream. Like when you were a fat little kid,
fuck, man,
you always wanted to make these big changes to your body, and
I used to look like. Like there's a, you know, kind of a side circumstance, a great moment in my bodybuilding career. You know, as a kid, I look at these guys in the magazines, like Don Long. I used to love him. You know, he just had this big, thick motherfucking look. I'm like, God damn, look at that guy. You know,
a great name too. Don Long.
And so,
Long Don.
So Don Long is interviewing me. Yeah, pull a picture of him up.
Yeah, stand by as I do this. I might have to.
Dude is
Long Don.
Yeah, put the safe search filter on.
And so when, you know, here's this guy that I used to look at the magazines, and now he's interviewing me after I win my pro card.
Yeah, you know? I remember him. He looked awesome.
Dude. Oh my God, yeah.
He had that mustache.
Crap. Great tan.
Yeah, mm-hmm. and so like, you know, that one of the cool things, like with him, he's interviewing me. He says, you know, hey, Jesus, you know, you haven't done much competing. I've never heard of you. Da, 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 da. I said, yeah. I said, this is my second contest. He said, oh, it's your second national. What was your first? I said, no, it was my second contest. He said, come on. You know, didn't want to believe. I mean, of course, he believed it was. I told him I wasn't joking. But so to go from, you know, idolizing this guy as a kid to have him interviewing me, getting my pro card, and then not believing the accomplishment I did was pretty freaking surreal, you know. So, you know, and here again, it's just the fact that I it's this overly focused, you know. I mean, I set my mind to something. It's the way that I do stuff. I mean, it's the whole thing with self-improvement, deep water. I mean, I it's just, you know, you set your mind to something, and, you know, like you said, you don't stop, you know. And it's a really, really empowering thing to feel like you can make a choice. Hey, I'm going to do this now, and that you can make that kind of progress that quickly.
Right.
You know, I mean, ultimately, I feel like people kind of handicap themselves by not giving themselves enough credit. You know,
people also just kind of they kind of block themselves. They're like in their own way.
Yeah, I mean, 100%. I mean, one of the things that I that I really hold myself true to now, that I repeat to myself and I tell other people when we talk about stuff like this, is I am willing to work harder / suffer more than anybody else, and that right there allows me to make progress faster. than the people around me. And I'm not some alien that was dropped here that has this capability. Mm. I just have, you know, I've got a way of thinking. I've got a philosophy. I've got a way that I do things. Mm. And it's not specific to me. It's specific to anybody who wants to pull their goddamn panties up, possibly pinch their hemorrhoid.
Stuff your hemorrhoid in.
And get to work, and you know? Get going. So it's, you know, it's definitely I've been blessed to have a lot of high points and to think that all of what we're talking about is tied together through busting my ass in the gym.
Yeah.
You know, I love it. I mean, it's the common thread of the whole thing, the training. I love it. You know, I absolutely love it.
I think some of the stuff you told me yesterday about being a fat kid and being bullied and then you said, yeah, like it hurt and it sucked. That this, these things were coming from me at different angles from other people. Mm-hmm. But what sucked was living with myself.
Yes.
And being a letdown to myself. 100%. And eating the Snickers and the Ben and Jerry's and everything else. And repeating that cycle day in and day out. And I think that's, I think that's just true of a lot of people. Like somebody says you're dumb. Somebody says you're fat. Somebody says this or that about you. It's really your own. Your own thought process about yourself.
Yeah.
You know, the only thing that really ends up mattering is...
It's so much easier to believe negative things about yourself than positive things.
Yeah. And the only thing that ends up really mattering the most is like self-respect.
Yeah.
You know, for yourself and not so much about what other people think.
100%. I mean, letting yourself down is the worst thing to do. I mean,
right.
Because if you let yourself down, you're going to let other people down. You know, the ones that are important to you.
I mean, you ever just get like, fucking furious about something and then you kind of realize, you stop and think about it for a minute and you're like... I'm fucking mad at myself.
100%.
I fucked up. I'm mad at myself. Like, you're like outwardly mad at someone close to you, but you're like, God damn
it. It's really not them.
Yeah. You're like, it's fucking me. Yeah. God damn it. And it makes you madder. You're like, that makes you the maddest.
Yeah. 100%. You know, it's like what you're saying. We talked about yesterday with the bullying thing. Of course, getting bullied sucked. You know,
right.
It was embarrassing and all the shit that went along with it, you know. But what was the most disappointing to me was how I handled it. You know, I ran to, I had an eating problem. I ran to the shit to eat to make myself feel better when
this is wrong, Mike.
I told myself.
No more Snickers?
I wasn't going to do it.
Snickers aren't the answer?
I'll give you Snickers after you give me the finger.
Now we're talking. Now we're talking. There's a Snickers up there, I swear. Keep
digging. Oh, yeah. Hey, yeah, see that brown thing?
Actually, it might be a Baby Ruth.
Yep. Keep digging.
Baby Ruth?
Oh, my God.
Yeah, so 100%.
Fast Times at Ridgemont High, right?
So 100% agree with you. It's the...
Caddyshack.
Caddyshack, too?
Caddyshack.
Oh, is it Caddyshack?
It's Caddyshack, the Baby Ruth floating in the pool.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, Caddyshack. Yes, right. Yeah, everyone bails out of the pool. Yeah, that's right. Caddyshack. I forgot about that scene. That's awesome.
Amazing.
Yeah.
All right, man. Well, I think we fucking smashed on just about everything today. We did a lot of YouTube videos as well. Did some photo shooting. Did some stuff with your shirt off. Did some stuff with your pants off.
This whole podcast was pants off.
Pants off. Yeah. Oh, yeah. They can't even tell.
Yeah, we all got no drawers on behind the table.
But pro of everything. Pro wrestler, pro bodybuilder, pro strongman.
Pro farter.
Just a professional farter. He can fart at a high pitch, low pitch. He can have bass. He can add treble to it. He can freestyle with it.
Yeah.
The freestyle noises he was making when he was lifting today and taking a shit and everything else.
All very impressive.
It was awesome having you here, John. It's always
Thank
a pleasure
you.
To kick it with you.
Where can people find you?
Have you here on the podcast.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
He has a website called deepwater.com. Yep. Don't forget, so I have to help him.
Deepwatermethod.com.
Deepwatermethod.com.
Yep. My personal website, jon-andersen.com. Keep in mind, my name is spelled J-O-N and Anderson, A-N-D-E-R-S-E-N.
You couldn't possibly make that any more complicated for the internet, could you?
Oh, I know. Although, if you Google even my name, not wrong, spelled properly,
your last
up.
Name just has E's in it, right, instead of O's.
Exactly, yeah.
There we go.
Yeah. And then there's the Facebook, which is John Strongman Anderson, and there's Instagram, which is John_Anderson, IFBB _IFBB Pro, then Twitter, which is the Jon Andersen. God, I'm having a brain.
Sounds good enough.
Stuff. Boom.
Yeah, there's some ways.
Well,
to
we'll
find me.
We'll link you to everything too,
you
so you can just check out any of our social media, and we'll link all this shit together. He's got a book, an ebook called Deepwater deep water method.
Yep.
And you're going to want to check that out. And John has some interesting thoughts about training, basically training like a lunatic and training without any carbs, which is always very controversial, but it's something that has worked well for him. He and I talked at length about it the other day, but basically just, you know, those of you that are kind of looking into trying a different diet, I wouldn't say just jump into and do exactly what he's doing. I would just say look into some of the things he's talking about and just think, maybe just cut your carbohydrates in half, you know, rather than get rid of them completely.
The interesting thing about what you're saying, Mark, is if in my book, in the Deepwater ebook, there's guidelines for someone that wants to try.
Right.
So it gives someone that wants to give it a shot a place to start.
There you go.
Because obviously it's a complex world. You can't just, like you said, you can't just decide one day, boom, I'm cutting this out. You got to have a little understanding of what you're doing, so right. you can be successful.
Yeah, and if you changed your diet tomorrow and started eating all kinds of different things that are foreign to you, it's going to upset your stomach.
Yeah.
Your results aren't going to be great, so you got to kind of ease your way into it. Anyway, he's got a great book. You're going to want to check it out. I'm at Mark Smelly Bell on Instagram and Twitter. Multiply your hustle, multiply your muscle, and may all your shits be tapered.
You can find me at Silent Mike with 2 K's, Instagram and Twitter, and Silent Mike 95 on the YouTubes.
I'm Jim McD, STTV, on Instagram and Twitter. Follow the show on Instagram at Mark Bell's PowerCast, Facebook.com/SupertrainingGym, and Twitter and Periscope at STJimSack. And we're out.
Later.
Mark Bell's PowerCast is a production of SuperTraining.com.